comes, if you think in terms of the main players in foreign policy making, I can think of the following. Of course, you have the parliament and various committees of the parliament which deal with foreign affairs, like the parliamentary committee, standing committee on external affairs. Then of course the prime minister himself or herself, and it has been the experience over last 65-70 years that most prime ministers have been their own foreign ministers, and they have taken extremely active and dynamic role in the area of foreign policy. Then there is the political affairs committee of the cabinet, finance, then the foreign minister, and the establishment of the Ministry of External Affairs of professional foreign service members and the Indian missions abroad. Within the Ministry of Establishment, you will be curious to know how policy actually is made, and I must share with you. We have the hierarchical structure which goes up from Under Secretary to Binary Secretary, and there are several layers: Under Secretary, Deputy Secretary, Director, Joint Secretary, Additional Secretary, Special Secretary, Secretary. Now, much of the foreign policy making, I must tell you, it is done by the Joint Secretary of the concerned division of a ministry. And if you are dealing with, say, Gulf countries, it is the Joint Secretary to whom most of the day-to-day papers come. He is the one who is going to say this course of action or that course of action, yes, no, and then submit it to the secretary concerned, and then it will go to the minister. More often than not, the action proposed by Joint Secretary goes through, and we may not say that, but that is the policy. Because policy is not something which is, you know, it's a great document or a piece of thought. It is usually the small decisions that also make policy. Whether a visit to Israel should take place or not. If not, why should not take place? Then what are the precedents? What are the past records? What is the advantage if the visit takes place? All that has to be put together, well argued, thought through, and then it should go with the recommendation that this is the proposed action by the Ministry of External Affairs, that minister should visit this country, should not visit this country, this agreement should be signed, or this is the kind of line of argument our permanent representative in the United Nations should take. He should abstain, or he should vote for, he should not vote. All this is decided through the discussions and analysis in the ministry. That is the policy. And this policy actually is made by a few individuals who are actually thinking about this subject, getting information from various sources and so on. So this is the setup. Of course, there are a large number of stakeholders in foreign policy making today, and there are other ministries of government as well. It is not only the Ministry of External Affairs, because the Ministry of Commerce is a big player as far as trade is concerned. Ministry of Industry for investments, Ministry of Defense for all the security issues, and now new issues which have come up like the climate change or environment, you have Ministry of Environment comes in. So there is a host of other ministries and departments which also go into policy making. For that, the mechanism is what is known as the Committee of Secretaries. That is the Cabinet Secretary who chairs this. We have here Secretary, former Secretary of Defense, Mr. Nimbalkar, who is very well familiar with this policy making. So these are the ways policies are made. In addition, today you have the vibrant Indian media, which is very vocal, very noisy, which is also proposing its own set of recommendations and actions besides the business and industry of India. Because even if government wants to enter into a free trade area agreement, say with ASEAN or with countries Japan or Korea, government has to consult with apex chambers of commerce and industry, be it CII or FICCI or ASSOCHAM and others. It is the Indian business's interests which have to be protected and promoted. So government and business have to work in synergy, in sync. Otherwise, there will not be any policy. And as you may have seen, for the last several years, not only with India, but even other foreign leaders, when they go on foreign visits, usually there is a huge entourage of top businessmen. In fact, they are the ones who are perhaps guiding the leader what kind of economic policies should be adopted. Because economic relations have now taken the center stage of foreign policy, and therefore every aspect of our relations has to be very carefully monitored and implemented. We have seen today that there is an explosion of information in the world, thanks to internet and communications and so on. But is information the policy? That is the question. Information is certainly power, because without information, you cannot exercise authority. But information cannot by itself be policy, because policy requires judgment. Policy requires thorough analysis of pros and cons. And it has to be predicated, it has to be located on your national interests. And how interestingly, even other scholars, notable scholar like Henry Kissinger, in his famous book called Does America Need Foreign Policy? He raises a question whether the new ways of processing information may not actually inhibit our capacity to learn in the field of international relations. For while the technological revolution provides extraordinary tools for the ordering of information, the successful conduct of foreign policy demands the intuitive ability to see the future and thereby master it. Leadership is the art of bridging the gap between experience and vision. I thought the remarks of Kissinger aptly describe the distinctive, rather defining role of leadership in foreign policy making, and not just left to the availability of information. To my mind, foreign policy and the process of formulation depend on several factors. The main tool to achieve its goals is diplomacy. How you conduct your foreign relations, how sophisticated it is, how nuanced it is, how you are able to create a perception about India and India's interests abroad. No matter how strong India is, what is India's strength, much depends on perception. And therefore, it is to the ability and skill of diplomacy that foreign policy success owes a great deal. And I should say that if you lack in that skill, then the country's interests are certainly harmed. And perhaps we did not do so a couple of hundred years ago. This is my personal belief, that India did not attach enough importance to its conduct of foreign policy at a time when India was a major strength, a major power in the 17th, 18th, 19th century. And we suffered a great deal as a result of that. But leave that aside. Today, the factors that can be identified for our present discussion. One is historical background of a particular situation or development. when you are talking of a policy, you must first go into his history, his background, his precedents, how it had so far developed, what were the causes and so on. Then the national and strategic interests related to that situation. If you are called upon to take certain action, then how your national interests, your strategic interests will be best served through this. So that means you have to really analyze the pros and cons. Domestic political considerations come into play. The parliamentary or the legislative opposition or support to that. After all, domestic policy and foreign policy are the two sides of the same coin. You cannot really distinguish. And there are many a situation in which foreign policy is strongly influenced by domestic considerations. And you know very well in the case of, say, our policy to Sri Lanka, or in the case of Nepal, what happens in Bihar or UP has a great influence on our policy to Nepal. Bangladesh vis-a-vis West Bengal or Assam or the Northeast states. So Manipur vis-a-vis Myanmar. There are such aspects which cannot be ignored. In fact, they go into the foreign policy making. Then international circumstances and global forces which have the capacity to impact our options, because our options are not in vacuum. They are subject to other forces as well. Role of leadership, we will come to that again in greater detail. Political economy. In today's world, as I said earlier, economic relations have become very important. It is the political economy of a country which really matters the most. It is the GDP of a country today is the mark, you know, the hallmark of a country's success. You flaunt your GDP. India is now going to be 8%, 9% growth rate, and the world will look at India very differently. Role and contribution of stakeholders, as I already mentioned, several stakeholders are there. And finally, the capacity of a state with regard to timely implementation of policy. I think that is really fundamental. The capacity of the country to deliver. Because no matter how much you talk and how much you promise, your credibility will depend how much you are able to really implement on the ground. India offers $5 billion of lines of credit to Africa. We have done it to Southeast Asia, similar number. Are we able to actually fulfill that commitment? We have decided to build several projects of connectivity. We talk of TAPI, Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India gas pipeline, or Iran, India gas pipeline, or the Sitwe to Mizoram, Sitwe in Myanmar, to Mizoram, more that is called the Kaladan multimodal link, partly on river, partly by road, link which will bypass Bangladesh, and we can bring straight away from Bay of Bengal to Mizoram and Northeast our goods without going through the chicken's neck in the Northeast. There are so many projects which are still under progress, and we are unable to deliver them on time. Now that is going to be the critical test, because other countries are not going to give credence to your promises and your big slogans if you are not able to fulfill them. So this is again one very important factor. Now it can be argued that in the foreign policy there is usually a sense of continuity. Now if you see right from Pandit Nehru's time up till now, of course Dilip just spoke about two republics which Raja Mohan has talked about in his book. Fair enough, I think there you can clearly distinguish three major phases. But the basic continuity goes on for the simple reason the foreign policy is based on certain principles, certain values, certain fundamental rights or interests of the country. They naturally get modified with time, with technological development and so on, but the basics don't change so substantially. And therefore, say in the case of India, the fundamental tenet of India's foreign policy is our freedom or our independence of holding a view on a particular situation or taking action independently. We are not going to listen to A country or B country, this power or superpower, because we are allied or we are indicted or we are obliged, nothing of that kind. We will take our own positions. And that is the basis on which initially the policy of non-alignment was coined. Of course, today non-alignment is not fully coherent or relevant because the Cold War ended, there are no two superpowers, no blocs and so on. And we are now what we call multi-alignment, or another word that is very commonly used now is strategic autonomy. Basically, it is the same thing, but we will put it differently in the changing context. Before I come to the present-day foreign policy narrative, I would like to very briefly touch upon a few developments from the past. And these I want to discuss. These I want to discuss in the context of the factors which I outlined earlier. 6-7 factors I said: leadership, national interest, capacity, domestic factors and so on. Now, these factors, when they operate on foreign policy, they will do either singly or generally in a combination. You will have several factors. You will have the pros and cons of a particular situation fully analyzed. You have the impact of leadership, or you have the global forces, forces of your other interests and so on. So I want to discuss, and I want to take your view also in this, how they relate to these factors. And I am going to illustrate these things from my own life in diplomatic service. I am going to have 4-5 issues or 4-5 major developments with which I was in one way or the other associated. How I saw them. One was Sikkim's integration with India in 1975, and I happened to be there for a very, very long time in Sikkim that time. Now, what happened in Sikkim around that time, finally, which led to the integration of Sikkim in India? It was primarily the development there in Sikkim, within Sikkim, they were arising out of the democratic urges of the common people of Sikkim and their demand for political reform, including abolition of monarchy and for being part of India. There were political maneuvers by the ruler Chogyal of Sikkim, and there were fears or apprehensions in India of foreign powers meddling in a very critical, strategically important area for us, namely Sikkim. Sikkim's strategic location, as you all know, is always very delicate from a defense point of view. And after 1971, after the Bangladesh war, it was even more critical. That time, on the Sikkim-India, Sikkim-China border, that is the Chumbi Valley and the Nathula Pass, things were, there was a red alert all along that time. Defense and security of India was always a prime consideration. So arising out of all this, political situation, uncertainty, domestic uncertainty, demands of the people for joining with India, changing of political system there, and the decisive leadership of Srimati Indira Gandhi, which were the factors which went into the policy that evolved towards Sikkim in those very critical years. Because what happened in Sikkim, integration of Sikkim, was of tremendous significance to India politically, defense-wise, security-wise. Now, situation, how does one analyze it? That's why I have presented this example. I mentioned nuclear issues, nuclear policy. On nuclear matters, India has all along followed a very consistent policy. That is, right in the beginning, we were in favor of nuclear energy for only peaceful purposes. Atom for peace in the 50s, in the 60s, we did not, you know, deliberately go into the nuclear, except energy issues throughout the 60s, we knew China exploded a nuclear weapon in 1964. So signing the NPT, which was based on our principles of equality, non-discrimination and independence. Non-proliferation treaty, the NPT, which was signed in 1967, violated the very principles for which India had stood. And therefore, in India, there was a consensus cutting across party lines. Everybody supported in the government position of not joining the NPT. And we stood by NPT throughout, even today. In 74, when Pokhran 1, that was the peaceful nuclear explosion, was conducted, India, after that, faced sanctions and severe criticism. The sanctions which were imposed on India remained throughout and which denied access to useful, important technology to Indian scientists. We were denied several items, equipment, materials and so on, and we had to live through this. The 1998 decision, it was a major policy decision of India to conduct nuclear tests. That was a demonstration of political will and full cooperation from all stakeholders, from scientists like Dr. Amitabh Malik, DRDO and other scientists, industry, because the equipment etc. produced for this was done by Indian industry, Indian diplomatic representatives, because this had to be presented outside India immediately, and all others. And subsequently, the Indo-US nuclear deal was an assessment and judgment of the prevailing international situation. How did India and the US come together after so much of recrimination by the US following India's nuclear tests? Within a couple of years after the test, a serious dialogue had started with Foreign Minister Jaswant Singh and Stroop Talbot, the Under Secretary of State. And subsequently, in 2005, 10 years earlier, the Indo-US nuclear deal discussion started. So, this is the kind of policy formulation which is done sensing where the world is going, how the US is looking to India at that time. US was very vulnerable after the 9/11 and the situation in Afghanistan, Iraq. India was a responsible power. India's record in the nuclear field has been impeccable. And there was no reason for the US to believe that India will violate if an agreement was reached between the two countries. And that is how the Indo-US nuclear agreement discussion started, finally culminated in an agreement which is really exceptional, because you see, the first time the US changed its own laws. The US agreed to sign an agreement with a non-NPT country. So this is a change of policy for the US, change of policy for India, and a major policy decision which shows that, and then when the subject came in the parliament, as you all recall, for the first time on a foreign policy issue, there was a vote of no confidence, which was defeated. And that time, the then Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, stood his ground and he won the vote. So, if there is a political will of that kind, you can sail through even against very stiff opposition in the parliament. Another topic I briefly want to touch upon is the end of the Cold War and disintegration of the Soviet Union. When this happened between 1989 and 1992, as Dr. Pavlova just mentioned, the great leadership of Prime Minister Narasimha Rao, this was a very uncertain time for India. And Prime Minister Rao himself describes it in his speeches that it was full uncertainty for the country. India did not know what role it will play. He was of the view that the end of the Cold War would not bring domination of one power, which was very much on the surface. You know, the US had emerged as one single power, a dominant power. And yet,